gospel is that God declares us righteous while we are still actually unrighteous in our
Then there is no sin we can commit that will cancel or negate the power
Jesus,
of his
I
death.
Believe in you. He said, all of your sins, past, present, and future, are thrown
so
into the sea of forgetfulness.
By the righteousness of Lord Jesus Christ, God looks at us and he doesn't see us within the context of our sin.
Not God's seeing a righteousness in us that we have done, that he may have helped us do, but rather, could it be that
they are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them?
Means that there is an alien righteousness.
We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For ye are not under the law, but under grace. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. For to be carnally minded is death. Pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, because it is written, Be ye holy, for I am. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Walk as children of light. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. That after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls.
Here we're going to address whether sin is natural or not. Okay, we're going to go over some things that are vitally important to your salvation experience. That I'm terribly afraid that too many people have looked over these doctrines and these teachings and they have not examined them for themselves with the Word of God. So we're going to go through this again and we're going to go over some of these teachings and these doctrines and what they imply and look at some scriptures and compare scripture with scripture to see whether man is a sinner by nature or by choice. So first I want to play a clip for you to listen to how this natural sin or this original sin teaching is relayed in the modern day churches. You must understand that the majority of churches are under this teaching, okay? Which means then of course we have different messages, okay? Because this teaching is the base on which everything else must be built. Because either man sins by nature or he sins by choice. These two are contradictions. You can't do it by both. So take a listen to this and then we're going to go over this.
What do you do when your back's against the wall? What do you do when you've got to bag the client? What do you do when you've got to make the sale? What do you do when your boss is eyeballing you? What do you do when your coach is right up close to your face mask? What do you do? What do you say? Do you lie? Or do you tell the truth? Are you dishonest? Or do you come clean? A lot of us are living behind layers and layers of lies. No one taught me how to lie. I just know how to lie. And I'm good at it. I just know how to tweak the truth. And so are you. You're in the same condition. You're in the same deal. When my son, EJ, was 3 years old, he hit his sister in the arm. And Lebeth ran up to me. She said, Dad, EJ's hit me in the arm. Look, there was a big welt there. I said, EJ, did you hit your sister? He said, no. Looked me square in the eye and just lied. No, Dad. Then I got smart. I used some psychology on him. I said, EJ, where did you hit your sister? He said, right there on the arm. I didn't teach him that. He's a natural born liar. I'm a natural born liar. You're a natural born liar. So let's just be honest, because we are in church. We're all liars. That's another thing. I always get freaky when someone says, to be honest with you. To be honest with you. To be honest with you. If someone says that a lot, you're talking to a liar. To be honest with you.
Now, as I mentioned before, this is the base teaching which all other doctrines and theological positions must be built from. You must understand that first, that until you deal with this issue, okay, what is sin? Then you won't have a clear definition of what is grace, what is repentance, what is faith, what is salvation. What does the Bible teach about those things? You see, so we have to grasp this first. Now, in that clip, Ed Young, okay, one of these mainstream preachers, basically used an illustration of his child, okay, and talking about his child is naturally born a liar, just like he is and his congregation, and everybody is, according to his theology and his theories. All right, he basically himself claims to be a liar as he preaches in the pulpit, and he says that his son follows suit. Now, we have to understand where he's coming from and why he's saying that. Many of us, like I say, we haven't looked into these things. But we must understand that he believes that sin is inherited and guilt is imputed due to the first parent's sin. All right? So, in other words, what he's saying is that his son sins not because he made a choice to tell a lie, but because he's born with a nature inside of him that necessitates him to tell a lie. And there's a lot more theology behind that. Okay, of how they get to these positions. But in the scriptures, it doesn't teach this propagation, as we're going to look at, the propagation of sin, how a sin is passed down. Okay, it doesn't teach that it's imputed or natural. Okay, we're going to see it teaches that it's imitated. It's an action we do. You see, the Bible calls sin transgression of law. Okay, it's not birth. And we're going to see that very clearly here. It says in 1 Peter 1:18, it says, aimless conduct is received by tradition from your fathers. You see, this is how they taught it in early times. That there was no natural sin teaching in the early church. Okay, nobody had such an idea that sin is passed down through their different ways of teaching this. Okay, it was understood as man was created with a free and independent will, which means he was responsible to repent of his sins, come to God through faith, and that he had to endure, okay, through that faith till the end to be saved. That's the way they taught it. That's the lives they lived. You see, but today there is no repentance being preached because they put sin in the nature. Well, if repentance is metanoia, change of mind, inclinations, opinions, desires, ways, well, how can you forsake your nature? Well, you can't forsake your nature. They put sin in the nature. So their repentance message is an apology, or it's a confession of sinfulness. It's never a stopping or a ceasing or, you know, forsaking any sin. There can't be any of that because they put sin in the flesh. You see, we got two options here. Either sin comes through birth and it's concupiscence, which concupiscence is basically your natural desires, or it's through example and it's a habit. You know, a copycat. Just like in this instance, we see that a kid, like we know all kids, when you're around them and you speak, they copycat what you say. That's why you got to watch what you say around kids. But if you're a reprobate, like this preacher, and I don't say it to be mean, but I say it to be truthful, he's destitute of the truth, okay? And we'll see that more as we look at some scriptures. Then how do you think his kid comes to that? You see, he thinks he's born that way. Well, what an excuse. Why would you ever have to stop doing it? It's not your fault. You just came into the world that way. So you'll never have to stop doing it, especially under his gospel and what he preaches. When in reality, he taught him that because he's, what, lying around his house. He's lying all day long, like he said. He said he's good at lying from the pulpit. It's outrageous what these men are preaching. But Peter said aimless conducts received by tradition. It says in Romans 5:12, this is one of the home runs they go to try to prove this this propagation of sin is natural and it comes down, you know, from Adam's nature, that somehow we've inherited this corrupt nature that necessitates our sin. It says over there in Romans 5:12, therefore just as through one man's sin entered the world and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sinned. See, because they believe that, well, all were in Adam when he sinned, they think that that's saying, well, we all sinned in the person of Adam. And then the majority of these guys, they teach that, well, then that sin's passed down through, you know, natural reproduction, okay, sex, and that's how it's passed down, or this concupiscence, just natural desire. That's the proof of original sin exists, that we all have just natural desires. You see, But if that's the theory we're to go with, then we have to go back to that verse and reevaluate it. Because in that verse, Paul said, therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world and death through sin. Well, see, they say the sin passed down to all men. Okay, that's how they teach it. That's why his son's born, you know, a sinner. That's why they're born and they're already dead in their trespasses and sins. But the problem is if sin is propagated through the male seed, okay, as they all taught, right? Well, then there would have to be two persons involved here. Because a child comes from parents, right? So, in other words, Adam couldn't have passed down sin by himself. You see, so it couldn't be by one man the sin came and was passed down and infected everybody as they teach this blue disease. You see, it would have had to have been by two persons. If Paul would have understood that theory in his time, he would have said through Adam and Eve it was passed down because that's where the sin comes down. But you know what? We can look at that scripture and we can see that. Like it says, therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sin, that one person can be one example. And that's what Paul's pointing out in Romans chapter 5. He's showing, he's contrasting the first Adam with the last Adam, right? Adam versus Christ. He's talking about an example, a pattern, a habit, an action. He's not talking about a passed down sinful nature or some dualism. All right, that was early false teachings that were refuted by the early church. Let's also understand that that passage strictly says that death passed to all men. Read it again for yourself. It says, and thus death spread to all men. It doesn't say sin spread to all men. It does say for all have sinned, but that is talking about an example, following Adam's example, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's moral. It's not a material. You see, let's understand that sin is not natural, okay? If lying was natural and not a choice, then why do kids and adults have shame and regret over lying to others? Okay, think about that. Why do people cover up adultery and murder? Why do they cover those things up if that's natural to do? Well, of course it's not natural. And in this instance, a child lies to cover up an action they committed that he or she knows was wrong, which means they naturally understand right from wrong, assuming they've reached the age of reason or the age of accountability, which a three-year-old child surely has not, as Ed Young uses in that illustration. But their God-given nature testifies against their choice that it was wrong, it was wicked, it was evil. See, the kid wouldn't lie because he's born a liar by nature. He would have lied to his dad, assuming again he made he's to the age of reason we're going to look at, okay, to cover up the deed he knew to be wrong. That's why he would lie. That's a choice. You see, that's not the way he's born. And to apply that's the way he's born is then to excuse him from ever taking responsibility for that thing. What do you do? If you believe that, do you even put the rod to the kid's back like the scripture says? Raise the kid in the admonition of the Lord? No, you don't do that. Because everybody's a sinner. Everything's sin. You see, and that's the way these men teach. Why do you think the professed Christians of our day are reprobated? Because they listen to these men, they've all shipwrecked their faith. That's why. These are the false teachers the scripture warns about. You see, it over in I thought about this. It says if sin or to lie is natural, then it follows that sinning and lying would yield a good and peaceable feeling as opposed to a rotten and bad one. Ask yourself and ask anyone if when they were in their sins, of course, you watching this, most of you are in your sins and you profess to know God with your mouth, but your heart's far from Him, and you know that it's wrong, and you know it convicts you, and you know it goes against your nature, just like homosexuality and all these other works of the flesh the Bible points out. Those things go against your nature, okay? And to imply, well, that's a part of who you are is, again, just to make it an inherited disease and excuse it. Because if somebody's born that way, okay, which the Bible clearly shows they're not, then you can't possibly bring that person to real godly sorrow and brokenness where they can come to Christ by faith. See, they'll never come to that repentance because they'll just dismiss it as, hey, it's just a part of my nature, it's just what I am. But sin is moral. It's an action. It's imitation. It's copycat. It's a pattern. It's a habit. It's not birth. It's certainly not concupiscence. It's not imputed, and it's not natural. You see, we must understand that, like, through this propagation, it's so true that our flesh does come from the first parents. Okay, for example, you go back to Genesis, All right, you can go to Genesis, and you can see that Eve was taken from the rib of Adam, right? So Eve was taken from his rib, and then when the Lord brought Eve to Adam, Adam said what? He said, now this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. You see, he didn't say this is soul of my soul or spirit of my spirit, because God didn't, Eve's soul did not come from Adam, just like our souls don't come from Adam. Certainly our flesh comes from Adam, okay, but our souls come from God. You see, but under this teaching, they say, well, the soul comes from Adam along with the flesh, and the sin's in the soul, and that's how it's passed down. That's the propagation they teach. So you're born naturally a liar. You're born with his corrupt and evil nature, a morally depraved nature, which means they might say you have the instrument of free will, but they mean you're only free to sin until you're already saved. You see, that's what they're really saying. You see, but that's sins. That's not how it works. Like Eve, our souls come from God. Our flesh comes from Adam, not our souls. You see, so once you understand that God creates man upright, okay, he's neutral, he's innocent, as we'll look at, then you'll realize that there is no passed down physical substance or stuff like sin that's enlodged in your nature. You see, but yet they go to the scriptures and they try to prove this stuff. You see, so what are some scriptures they use to try to get this across on people? Well, they go to the Old Testament, and if you've done your homework, and if you know where Christianity sprang from, you realize it came from Judaism. Now, you could search Judaism until your heart's content, and you'll find they never taught this doctrine of original sin. They always teach, and always have taught, back to Moses, that sin is a choice. It's a moral choice. The free will of man is free, and it's able to obey God or disobey God. They say it's a choice between Yetzer Tov, the moral conscience, and Yetzer Ra, which is the natural instincts. Neither of those things are sinful. Okay, neither of them. Concupiscence is not sinful. How do we know concupiscence is not sinful? Because the scripture confirms it. You see, Eve had this concupiscence prior to ever eating from the tree which spiritually slewed her and Adam, right? Because we see that in Genesis 3:6, okay, there was a tree, right? The tree of knowledge, it was off limits, okay? Of course, the tree of life, right? Well, that tree that Adam and Eve had to eat from, because why? They were created mortal. And so they had to eat from that tree, and as long as they had access to that tree, they were in communion with God, they had eternal life. That tree did. Okay, the fruit, they had access to that, but through their sin, they got cut off from that tree. Well, again, our souls don't come from Adam and Eve. Our soul comes from God, so our flesh, we lost access to that tree in the physical sense, just like 1 Corinthians 15, 21-22 talks about getting back access to that tree, okay, in glorification, a glorified body, right? But In Genesis 3:6, we see that the tree they were told not to eat from, okay, they had knowledge of that they transgressed that knowledge, and of course, through the temptation of Satan, they died. Now, they were born mortal, so they did not physically die, they spiritually died. Here's what it says in Genesis 3:6. It says, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, and desirable to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate, and then she gave to her husband, and he ate. Now, the importance of that passage is that shows that Adam and Eve both had the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. They had those temptations, those desires. You see, they had that before they ever transgressed God. That was the base of the temptation. Like James says, when anyone's tempted, he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed. And when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin's full grown, it brings forth death. That's what happened to Adam and Eve in the garden. That's what happens to us when we sin against God. We're tempted. We have the likeness of the passions and desires of Adam and Eve. Those things are not sinful. They come from God. How could she have those desires and be in communion with God if those desires are wicked and sinful? There is no metaphysical change in nature when they ate from the fruit passed down. That's all part of this traducianism teaching. That the soul bears the sin and is propagated. That's how wickedness is propagated. But that's not what the scripture teaches. But nevertheless, they'll go to some of the old Old Testament scriptures and try to say, well, this is teaching original sin. Psalms 51:5. I'm sure most of us are aware of this. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. There's predominantly, today, most folks who've been in the church, they go right to that. But again, Judaism has never taught this original sin thing. Psalms 51:5 says you're born in sin, meaning a sinful world. It does not say that sin was born inside of you. Sin is moral. It's not nature. Okay? Sin is a choice. It's not something you are. It's something you do. You see, you could understand this in the modern day vernacular like this. You must understand there's a difference between being born in a hospital, like being born in sin, and having a hospital born inside of you, sin being born inside of you. You see, those aren't the same thing. And that's not what David's saying. Because nowhere does the scripture teach that sin's a substance. You see, that was brought in by Augustine. And that's what I try to point out, Augustine in an original sin video. You see, if sin is a physical property that dwells in human nature, as these guys are teaching that, oh, I'm born this way, I'm born a liar, I'm born a sinner. Okay? If it dwells in your nature apart from choice, meaning apart from your submission to the flesh, apart from you living according to the flesh and dying, apart from you submitting to the desires of your flesh, apart from you doing that, if sin dwells in your flesh, then we have to ask and then answer the question, how did Jesus Christ come in the flesh? How did God manifest in the flesh? How did the Word become flesh and dwell among us? He could not have. And that was the error the early church refuted heavily. That was the problem when you put sin in the flesh. That was early errors. You can research this stuff. You can figure this stuff out. You see, there is no sin in the flesh. So yes, our flesh comes from the first parents. There's no sin in the flesh. The soul comes from God. So there can be no transmission of the sin through natural reproduction or through, like some teach today, God imputes the sin to the soul. If that was true, that would make God the author of sin. You see, if God creates the soul with the body at the moment of conception, well then He can't impute any sin to that soul, because why? The sons won't bear the iniquity of the father, neither will the father bear the iniquities of the son. You see, God doesn't impute that sin. That shows those of you who teach that and embrace that, you're showing God to be unjust and a tyrant, to punish people for sin they didn't even commit. You see, and you can explain it all you want, but the scripture confirms that God will not impute that sin. And since He creates the soul, omnipotence, then we must understand that there is no sin in the soul, not from birth. Now, another scripture they use is Psalms 58:3. It says, the wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they are born, speaking lies. You see, that would fit illustration Ed Young gives. My kid's born that way. But again, just like Psalms 51, this is not to be taken literal. You see, I didn't cover that part in Psalms 51:5. You know, if you were to take that literal, that, hey, I'm born in sin, well, it goes on to say, you know, in verse 7, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which you have broken may rejoice. Well, if I'm born a sinner, like they're all trying to imply by that, then it must also be true that I can be purged with hyssop, that I can become whiter than snow, and that my bones, God will break them, and they'll rejoice. That's not true. It's a hyperbole. Okay, it's an expression. Same thing here, that we know that babies and toddlers, they cannot yet speak. We all know that. It defies logic to say that they can. Yet this psalm is not to be taken in the literal sense. It defies sound reasoning. You see, babies also do not have teeth. And why is that important? Because that same psalm, just a couple verses later, says this. It says, their teeth in their mouth, O God. You see, babies don't have these teeth. So God's not breaking out babies' teeth. He's not speaking about infant children. Judaism's never taught such a thing. Wickedness is a result of a choice. It's not an inherited disease. You see, Romans 9:11 says, for the children not yet being born have done neither good nor evil. See, there is no good or evil apart from a choice. That's why we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ and give an account to the deeds done in the body, whether good or bad. There's the independent will most of you deny. You're going to give an account, and it's not for rewards. It's going to be entering the kingdom or not, being living worthy of this gospel or not. Jesus said In Matthew 18:3, assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. And in Matthew 19:14, he says, let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of heaven. Christ likened little children to the kingdom of heaven. He said, you must be converted and become like a child. A child is innocence. A child is not in bondage to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. It doesn't have those things. They haven't even come to the age of reason with those things yet. You see, that's what Christ likened it. Okay? Children, yes, children, they heed the parent, their parents' voice. You see, there's different elements in humility, of course, is what he's speaking about there. But the point is, he's showing that the kingdom of heaven was likened to children. You see, there's innocence there. That's all we're saying. It's just innocence. There's no good and there's no evil. There's no righteousness and there's no unrighteousness. Okay? That stuff is all moral choices. Another one they use is Job 14:4. It says, who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean? Not one. Again, if you Job and read the whole context, you'll see Job is speaking about an old man dying, basically, is what that's dealing with. I just pulled that portion to show this to you. But this is used to basically imply that sinful parents breed sinful children. So if that's the case, and you don't believe in immaculate conception, let's say, then now you have to answer the question, how did Mary, who was born a depraved sinner, because she came from a mom and dad, right, how did she bear the Lord Jesus Christ without sin? Remember, Psalms 51:5, as all these people advocate, say, well, that means you're born in sin. Well, Psalms 51:5 doesn't say anything about the male seed, which is where like guys like Augustine and others would put the sin at. You see, it says the sin comes from your mother. So Christ not only would have been unclean, like that scripture says, if that's alluding to children, but he would have been born in his mother's iniquity. You see, that's how they got around Christ coming in the flesh, because they put sin in the male seed, and they say, well, Christ didn't have male seed. Well, then, but Mary did, so they had to make immaculate conception on the Catholic side of things, all right? And that's how they got around that. But that can't possibly be what it's dealing with. You see, because under that teaching, they also teach that infant baptism stuff. Well, babies have to be baptized. Why? Because if they're not, then they go to hell. Why? Because they're born with this substance called sin, and God has to punish that sin. You see, God's going to put babies in hell for a sin they didn't commit. That paints an unjust picture and a tyrant-like picture of the Lord, who the Bible shows is compassionate and loving and long-suffering. Surely his wrath, goodness, and severity of God, yes. But we're looking now at innocence, you see, and children are innocent. God does not hold the Son accountable for the sins of the Father. But let's just say this infant baptism thing, okay, in regards to this. They teach that infant baptism thing remits the sin. So it would follow that if two Christians who have been baptized get together and have a child, they've both had that original sin removed through baptism, okay, remits the sins. Well then, how do they pass along this sin to their children? It's been remitted through baptism. You see, Augustine and these other guys say, well, the sin's passed down through the male seed. Well, wait, it's remitted. It's gone. You see, it couldn't possibly be passed down. That doctrine goes away. You see, but see, they won't even look at that. And I've talked to people about that, and they just ignore it. They don't even know what to say. Okay? See, those are just a couple of the Old Testament scriptures they use. There's not very many more. Okay? One of the New Testament ones they use is over in Ephesians 2:3. Okay, it talks about being a child of wrath by nature. Let's read the full context, verses 1 through 3. And here's what's said. Paul says, and you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature were children of wrath, just as others. See, there it is. You're by nature a child of wrath. They never compare that to Romans 2:14 that says the Gentiles by nature do the things contained in the law, because, you know, even though they don't have the law, they show the work of the law written in their hearts, and their conscience accuses or else excuses them. See, they never compare that. Nobody ever thinks, well, if I'm born, okay, with this wicked nature, then how can the Gentiles do what's good by nature? You see, it would be that this nature would make them only do evil, and that's what this is implying. Well, you're born a sinner, you're born a liar, you're born a homosexual, whatever else. You're born that way. It's not something you do. You see, but let's understand here that in the first part, you know, he said, "He who he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins," due to their covenant theologies, they say, well, see, you died in Adam. But nowhere does that scripture say you were born this way. You're not born in dead in trespasses and sins. Paul wasn't teaching that. Paul was taught in other parts of the scripture that it's by wicked works. Okay, like in Colossians 1:21, it says in Isaiah 59:2 that your iniquities have separated you from God. He won't hear your voice. It's your iniquities. It's something you've done. If you look up that word by nature and compare it to this context, then you're going to see the correct definition that fits it is the one that says it's a mode of feeling and acting by which long habit has become nature. Look that up in the Greek. And how do we know? Because just read the context. It says he's talking about a way you used to walk. He's talking about a way you used to conduct yourselves in the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. See, that's what a child of nature is, someone who is in bondage to the flesh, which then means they've come to the age of reason, and they've made a choice to live according to the flesh and die. They're not, you know, born a sinner through this propagation of the soul or through inherited or imputed sin. Okay, inbred sin is heresy. The Bible does not teach such a thing. So understand that and read that and study that and examine that. That it's a habit. It's something you do. It's an example. That's what he's talking about. Imitation, not imputation. You see, wickedness is aimed at morality, as is righteousness. So when a lot of these guys go back to the beginning, like with Noah, like in Genesis 6:5, you know, before the Lord was going to flood the earth, you know, and why was he going to flood the earth? Because why? The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. All right? Now, they'll say, well, see, that's the way you're born. See, you got to understand the theology behind that. That's not the way you're born. They've never taught such a thing. You see, it can't be that's the way you're born because Noah was upright. He was perfect in his generations. Okay, there's others, Abel, Enoch, there's others in the scripture that are shown to be righteous. Okay, so what these men are teaching is they're trying to imply, well, you're born this way, when in reality this is an action you do. Why was Noah saved from this flood? Because he was a preacher of righteousness. That's a choice he made. It's morality, you see. But back to this scripture, why was the wickedness of man? What the Lord, see, they say today, well, God came and looked upon sin, right? Well, it says God looked and he saw the wickedness of man was great, so he could see it, okay? But why? What was so wicked here? What was going on? It says in verse 12 of Genesis 6, it says, so God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Back to Ecclesiastes 7:29, God made man upright, but man sought out many schemes. Man corrupted their ways. God didn't make you corrupt. Your nature is not corrupted through Adam. See, that's just an ancient false teaching that's been passed down. It even says in Genesis 8:21, the Lord smelled the soothing aroma. Then the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground for man's sake, although the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. That word is na'ur in the Hebrew. Okay, it does not mean birth. And that passage does not say man's born a sinner or that his heart's wicked from birth. You see, if you look that up, you're going to find out when it uses the word youth. Like when David fought Goliath, it was in his youth. It talks about the wife of your youth. It's not the way you're born. See, you're not born that way. You're born neutral and innocent. These are choices that come with an age of knowledge, which we're going to look at right now. It says in Isaiah 7:15 and 16, this is in reference to Christ. It says, curds and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land that you dread will be forsaken by both her kings. You see, there's a time, according to that scripture, that before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose the good. You see, there's a time frame there. It's innocence. Okay, it says in Deuteronomy 1:39, moreover, your little ones and your children who you say will be victims, who today have no knowledge of good and evil, they shall go in there, to them I will give it, and they shall possess it. You see, again, that Moses, all the way back to Moses. Okay, and what did he say? He said that your little ones and your children have no knowledge of good and evil. What did Christ liken to the kingdom of heaven? The little children. You see, they go to the kingdom of heaven. There's no dreadful decree in the scriptures. That was taught by tyrant men, false teachers. Okay, that's not what the scripture's teaching at all. The Bible says, therefore, to him who knows, there's the key, to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. That's what sin is when you know to do good and you don't do it, it's sin, and your conscience bears witness against you. You see, further proof of this is found by Paul's own pen, which they all try to use to try to prove that he was teaching this transfer of sin. He was not teaching a transfer of sin. In Romans 7, verses 9 through 7, here's what Paul said. He said, "What shall we say then? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, I would not have known sin except through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, 'You shall not covet.' But sin, taking opportunity by the commandment, produced in me all evil manner of evil desire. For apart from the law, sin was dead." He says, "I was alive once without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died." You see, this is clear proof that Paul said sin is dead because it does not live in infants who are without the law. Sin is dead apart from the law. It says in Romans 4:15, "For where there is no law, there is no transgression." This is understood as a knowledge of the law. There is an age of innocence. Sin is not imputed where there is no law. It says in Romans 5:13, and it says in Romans 3:20 that law brings about the knowledge of sin. You see, 1 John 3:4 says, "Whoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is transgression of the law." Whether it's Gentiles who have the law written on their heart, when they transgress that, when they come to understand right from wrong, that's where the transgression is. You see, but yet Paul claimed to be alive before this knowledge was obtained. You see, what I'm trying to point out here is that apart from the law, sin is dead. Infants don't have knowledge yet. Okay, and so even if they do things like they push each other and they bite and they kick and they scream and they cry, that's not sin. You can't call that sin because there's no knowledge involved there. Okay, you can tell, you can look kids, see there's no knowledge there. You see, there has to be an age of accountability, and that's what it teaches. They have to know to do right and do wrong. All right. That's what the Bible teaches. So back to his illustration, if the child had reached an age of reason and then he'd lie, he would know he did wrong, and he'd cover it up. You see, there's many elements that play into this, and they just give you, well, this original sin teaching, well, sin's natural. Sin's not natural. Again, if sin was natural, then doing those things would feel good. Sinning would feel good, but sinning doesn't feel good. All right, understand this. Now, I want to get back to Ed Young here for a moment. I want you to understand that this man does not meet the qualifications for a spiritual leader according to the Bible. This is a very serious thing here, because this man has much material up online and a huge ministry that's after his own name and all this and that. And many people flock to this guy, especially because he preaches to these young kids. But what he's preaching is lies, okay? They're fables, like the scripture points out. First, let's understand that Ed Young is an admitted lying preacher from his own pulpit. You see, we want to look at what the scripture says about this. It says in 1 Timothy 3:8, it says, "Likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy for money." You see, but greedy for money. Well, you are these people always asking for love offerings, right? Buy my DVD, buy my study Bible, do this, do that. You see, that's what they sell the gospel. They don't preach the gospel, okay? But these men are they're what? They're double-tongued. Well, double-tongued, what is that? A double-tongued is a proof that the double mind is at work. What did James say? A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. He can't receive anything from God, right? So if you're double-minded, you're double-tongued, well, you're saying one thing, you're saying another, okay? Then it goes to the divided in heart. Like Christ said, you can't be. No one can serve two masters. You're either a slave to sin or a slave to righteousness. You can't be both, right? It's just like when we go back, you know, thinking about this now, like how these men teach, well, concupiscence, just your natural desire, sinful, which I showed you is not sinful because Eve and Adam had it prior to ever this, you know, fall they teach. Now, Christ said in the scripture, he said if you look at a woman to lust for her, right, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. You see, that would be likened to this concupiscence they talk about. Well, he said, if your right eye causes you to sin, what do you say? Pluck it out, cast it from you, for it's more profitable for you that you lose one of your members and your whole body be cast into hell whole. So the question is, if this concupiscence, see, the reason they teach where you sin every day with omission and commission is because you always have concupiscence. They liken temptation to sin. Again, what about Christ? Didn't Christ come in the flesh? He was tempted in all points as we are, made like his brethren in all points, like Hebrews 2 and Hebrews 4 points out. But nevertheless, how could you pluck out your eye? Talking about inward lust, of course. That's what he's referencing there. He's lusting in your heart. That's not the actual committal of adultery. You do it in your heart. You already did it. Why? God's looking on the heart. That's why. How does that work? See, it crosses out what Jesus taught, just like this whole entire natural sin thing does. You see, and that's what these men are teaching. They're fables, okay? So understand this. It says in 1 Timothy 3:10, it says, but let those first be tested. Let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. Again, blameless. You're telling lies out of the pulpit? People don't see a problem with that? It's outrageous. It really is. It says over in Titus 1:7, it says, bishop must be blameless. All right, you got to be blameless. Double-tongued, telling lies, like he admits to in his own pulpit. It's not blameless, okay? It even talks about, you know, in Ephesians 4:25 that, you know, the lying has to be put off. He's referencing the old man. You know, Paul talks about putting away lying. Let each one of you speak the truth to his neighbor. Well, putting away lying, if you look up that putting away, it means to put off. It basically means to quit, to stop. And that was something that had to happen when you come in to Christ. You may have been a liar before. You may have been involved with wickedness before, but when you come in, you're in the body of Christ, you no longer do those things. Because those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Okay? It says in Exodus 20:16 that you shall not bear false witness. Well, how does that work under this preaching today? Well, under this preaching today, well, you're born this way, so you can't be responsible for it, so you can't obey God, you can't even repent of your sins, you can't even have faith, you can't do any of that stuff, so it turns into all this theological mumbo-jumbo, and then basically, the commandments don't matter no more, because why? They teach, well, Christ kept the commandments for you. You trust that he kept the commandments for you. Not only is his righteousness imputed to your account, but his obedience is transferred to you. So now sin can be transferred, which they try to teach from the scripture. Now righteousness and obedience can be transferred. So what is there for you to do? Absolutely nothing. They say trust. So they make you a hearer of the word, right? Like the scripture warns, if you're a hearer of the word, you're deceived, right? Well, that's what they make if they make you a hearer of the word only. And you're self-deceived, and they preach the devil's faith, faith alone, faith by itself, saves the soul, when the scripture says faith has to work by love, because faith cleanses the heart of sin, purges the conscience, right? That's what happens. That's the working dynamic of the gospel, okay? Faith working by love. There's no working element over here. It's just the dead man's faith. And that's why these people, like I said earlier, they shipwrecked their faith because they rejected heart purity, love from a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith. 1 Timothy 1:5. It goes on to say, if you reject that, you suffer shipwreck. Now, Proverbs 6:16 through 19, listen to what this says. It says, these six things the Lord hates. Yes, seven are an abomination to him. A proud look, a lying tongue. There's Ed Young. There's Ed Young and all the people he's preaching to, because they all think because the preacher says okay to lie, they can be liars. Hands that shed innocent blood, probably referencing the many stories in the Bible where they killed children. They were innocent. Okay? A heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil, a false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among the brethren. There it is, twice. A false witness and one who has a lying tongue. Both fit Ed Young. It's an abomination to the Lord. You see, it doesn't work. Because the scripture is very clear that those things had to be done away with. Okay? That grace doesn't cover your sins. It doesn't give you a cloak for your vice. Grace is supposed to purge you and cleanse you and lead you teach you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust, to live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, righteously and godly in telling lies? See, that's the thing about these guys. Out of one side of their mouth, they say, well, you're going to be sinning every day. You have to sin every day because you got concupiscence, temptation, sin. And on the other side of their mouth, they say, well, you got to live above sin. You got to do the right thing. So they preach a moral message, but it's all based on the lie of this natural sin. You see, that's why, again, the repentance message has nothing to do with like, Proverbs. There was that one proverb. It says, if he who covers his sin will not prosper, but he who confesses his sins and forsakes them shall have mercy. Well, they confess them. They believe, but they don't do. They don't repent. See, their repentance is just, well, I admit that I'm sinful. I admit that this is true, that I have sinfulness inside of me. I never stop it because it can't ever be stopped, you see? It can never be stopped because they put sin in the flesh. And the majority of these preachers today are teaching this stuff. But back to the lying tongue. It says in Revelation 21:8, this should really wake you up out there to think about these things. It says this. It says, but the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Scripture gives clear warning from a God who is not a respecter of persons that if you tell lies and you're in bondage to such lie telling, okay, that you have your part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. That should be a clear warning to you that what this man's teaching has nothing to do with the grace of God, with the redeeming value. See, that's the purpose of the gospel, is to redeem you from the corrupting influence of sin. Christ came to destroy the works of the devil. The devil was a liar from the beginning, the scripture says. Okay, just like we see in the garden to today, he's telling you lies. Well, sin's natural. You could live in your sins. God can't see you sinning. Hey, your future sins are forgiven in advance. God's cool. He's your buddy. God loves you. See, that's what they're preaching today. You see, and so you've lost all concept of judgment and of God's wrath. You see, and the scripture warns about this. The wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. You see, the scripture is very clear about this, that to those who by patient continuance in doing good that seek for glory, honor, and immortality, they get eternal life. But to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth but obey unrighteousness, they receive indignation and wrath. Okay, Paul said, in flaming fire, the Lord's coming back, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, you need to heed these warnings now so you don't get sent away at that judgment later. So my conclusion to this matter is this, is that sin must be divided. Sin is not flesh. Sin is submission to the flesh. Okay, that's a big difference. Sin is choice. It's not nature. Surely sin can become a second nature through an example and by habit, but it's not something you're born with doing, because sin's not a physical issue. Sin is a moral choice. Okay? That's what the scripture teaches. We have the likeness of the first parents' passions and desires, but like them, we have to sin against God before we're dead in our sins. See, sin is not natural or a part of human nature. If it was, then God would have never manifested in the flesh, because he would have had sin by taking on human nature. There is no sin in human nature. Concupiscence is not sin. Temptation is not sin. Christ was tempted in all points as we are, yet he had no sin. And back to repentance. Until a person repents, okay, in the biblical sense, which is not that you're born this way, but that you become this way through a long-practiced habit, until they repent and turn from their sin, then they'll never be able to be reconciled to God through the blood of Christ. You cannot touch the blood of Christ. You cannot come back into a personal relationship with God until you go through godly sorrow and brokenness and repentance, and you come to God through real, genuine brokenness and contriteness. Then, and only then, when you come in that manner, like the scripture says, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and then you receive with meekness the implanted word that's able to save your soul. The wicked man has to turn from his ways. Let the wicked man forsake his ways, the unrighteous man his thoughts. Then let him return to the Lord. Then the Lord will abundantly pardon. You see, you don't get pardoned while you're still in your sins. See, that's a concept that's missing today because they put sin in the nature when sin's a choice, as shown through the Bible. So until a person departs from iniquity, like Paul said, let those who call on the name of Christ depart from iniquity, then they're workers of iniquity. You see, and the workers of iniquity, at that judgment that Christ pointed out is coming, they get sent away. So I put this forth to show you very clearly. You need to examine these teachings. Quit taking men for what they say. Examine it for yourself. You see, do that this one time. Look into what we're saying. Look into what we're trying to show you. It's so important. It is so important. We're talking about our eternal destinies here. We're talking about the Word of God here. We're not talking about nonsense. We're talking about the truth versus a lie. There is no lie that's of the truth, the Scripture says. We're talking about the spirit of error versus the spirit of truth. We're talking about what the Bible teaches. And unless many of you out there awaken to this in a hurry, then there's just no hope for you. It just seems as you're so caught up in these teachings that there's just nothing we can say to wake you up to it. We're going to keep trying. We're going to keep coming for you. Okay, the long-suffering of God, He's not giving you assurance of your salvation. He's giving you time to repent. You see, that's what the Scripture teaches, that He's long-suffering, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. So He calls and He draws and He stretches forth His hands towards you in His compassion. But there will come a time when that's cut off, and then the severity of God will be here.